And there was a pretty scary situation in Congress last month or 2 months ago where there were some bills that were designed to stop copyright theft that all of a sudden it became you're trying to kill the internet. And, you know, maybe we can work with our friends in the internet community to try to come up with a reasonable solution to that, because I don't think they want people to be able to just sort of brazenly steal other people's product. But so there's a happy medium there, but it is a real problem. Copyright is such a valuable industry in the United States, and it creates so many jobs that we do risk losing those jobs if we're not careful and don't protect copyright.
So now with the innovation of internet, which has just imploded around the globe now, and handheld devices, and who knows where the future is going. Pretty soon we'll have probably a device that does everything for us, including pay our bills, with PayPal and or automatic scheduling. Where do you see the exciting new opportunities of the future as you gaze into the NAB crystal ball?
You walk this floor and, and talk to people who have great ideas, and you know, to try to predict where this industry is headed in 10 years or even 5 years, it's really a tough call. But the message is, if you've got great compelling content, you're going to have a good business at some point. I also tell people that if you've got teenage sons and daughters, encourage them to become a copyright lawyer.
Right.
Because as we were talking about sort of protecting intellectual property a minute ago, I think that is a growth business. So
truly is.
Mama, let your babies grow up to be not cowboys, but intellectual property lawyers.
And maybe not even rock stars, because they don't have to go on tour. They can just sit in an office and collect paycheck kerchings.
Yeah.
As NAB is evolving into the future, do you see it becoming more of a global entity? You say one third is already international.
Yeah, I mean, this truly is the number one global media technology show already, and we're always trying to improve it.
Right.
There's going to be $30 billion, that's billion, in sales generated from this show.
Just from this show alone?
Just from this show alone. So it's to the Las Vegas economy. It's $120 million to the Las Vegas economy, and that doesn't include gambling either. So
and that doesn't include my cut either.
Oh, I've heard you make a lot of money.
Well, yeah, so. I wish. So, if it's $30 billion at this show, what is the industry as a whole with broadcasting and entertainment, in your opinion?
The TV business in the U.S. is about an $80 billion a year business. The radio business is about a $20 billion a year business, give or take a billion or two. But the great thing about the broadcast business is we've cycled out of the worst advertising recession in the last 50 years, and now the economy has bounced back. Car advertising is booming. Political advertising is helping broadcasters. So life's good to be a broadcaster, right? Again.
So the trickle down and the economy and all the bailouts, did that really impact the broadcast industry, or did it actually rise during the period?
When we were in this recession about 3 years ago, there were people wondering, wow, are we going to come out of this? And we really have sort of led the recovery. Advertising typically, broadcasting particularly, leads the economy when it goes down, but we're also on the front edge when there's a rebound. So we've had a good sort of bounce back, rebound in the advertising economy, particularly for broadcast television, radio, not quite so good, but doing pretty well. So it's a good time to be a broadcaster.
Any thoughts on how radio is going to continue to reinvent itself? Because it's certainly not the radio it used to be, with a powerhouse of a station where you had a 10 share in the market.
Yeah, I think we've just had a press conference yesterday about getting HD radio onto smartphones. We think that, you know, digital radio, where you're doing multicasting, where you're offering not just one program stream, but multiple program streams simultaneously. So if you don't like, a modern rock station on your on 106.7, they might be offering a classic rock or a bluegrass channel, for example. At work, I listen to a bluegrass channel because I like bluegrass music.
Well, CBS is doing that in L.A., or at least they were doing it with HD1 and right. HD2 with K-Earth, yeah. where one would be focusing on like the oldies cafe of the 50s, 60s genre, right. while K-Earth is obviously more mass appeal and more broad-based.
Yeah. So it's great. I mean, it's good for the consumer. It gives them a better experience in terms of a niche format that they might not have otherwise gotten on traditional analog radio. So it's all about providing consumers with compelling content again, and the fact that we can offer more choice, free to the listener, that's a good thing.
Well, and if correct me or if I'm misstating this, but with broadcasters, there's ways to make new increased revenue even through using their towers to help transmit 4G signals now yes. or other telephony broadcasts that won't interfere with their broadcast.
That's true, and that's a new revenue stream. It's called NTR, non-traditional revenue, but offering sort of broadband services mm-hmm. using our towers, which are ubiquitous in major cities, and you know there is this alleged spectrum crunch, and we can be a part of the solution to this spectrum crunch or crisis, whatever you want to call it. So we've embraced that idea, and a lot of broadcasters are making some actual real money on it.
So statistically, educate me. How many people, how many countries, revenues, what are the big awe things that people go, wow, I didn't know that
so
about
at
NAB?
At this show, there are 156 countries represented. We've
right.
got first-time visitors from Latvia, Chad. There were two other countries that I can't think of, but one in three attendees from outside the United States.
Wow.
Very impressive.
Huge.
One in four exhibiting company on the floor, 1,600 exhibitors, one in four are from outside the United States. So the brand, the global brand of NAB, a lot of people think of NAB as a lobbying organization. That's what we do
right.
year-round. We're an advocacy organization in Washington, D.C. So people who come to the NAB show, a lot of them they only identify NAB as the NAB show in Las Vegas, whereas the rest of the year, we're lobbying Congress and advocating on behalf of broadcasters. So it's sort of this bifurcated company that I work for, where I'm talking about FCC regulation
right.
most of the year, and then about February, I think, okay, we got this incredible show where we have to build a city in a couple of weeks
Literally.
Of 100,000 people and put on the greatest technology show on the planet and then tear down the city about a week later and say, we'll see you again next year. So,
do you ever see the expansion maybe, and maybe I'm thinking too far ahead, but where as it continues to grow globally that there will be an INAB and you'll do an international show maybe in Europe?
We actually used to have a radio conference
right.
in Europe that we sort of put on hold because during the recession of a few years ago, but there are opportunities to do sort of new creative conferences, and we have a radio show in the United States every
right.
year, which will be in Dallas this year in September, but I think, you know, we're going to do our best to serve our membership, which is we have about 7,000 TV stations, local TV stations, and about 7,000 radio stations and about 1,200 TV stations in membership. We also represent all the major broadcast networks in the United States. So there are opportunities to do other conferences.
Huge. Dennis Wharton, you're the Executive Vice President of Communications for National Association of Broadcasters. Yeah. Any closing remarks that you could illuminate?
No, we really appreciate you being here
Thank
and
you.
Reporters being here. This year we've topped over 1,600 reporters,
wow.
which is by far the most reporters we've ever had, and we just hope you're having a great experience and you'll come back year after year because we'll be here.
I actually have been coming for year after year and I'll continue to report on it for year after year.
Great.
I'm Kurt Kelly from Live Video Inc. and Actors Reporter with Dennis Wharton, who is the Executive Vice President of Communications at the greatest broadcast show in the world.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for being
Thank
here.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank
what
you.
I'd like you to do, if it's all right,
okay.
just a couple of quick throwaways that we can use as bumpers with
sure.
you, your name, and Kurt Kelly's coming up on Actors Report. Whatever
yeah.
you ad lib as a journalist.
All righty.
Kurt, or Dennis?
Yeah.
So I'll need to get something so I can spell your name
sure.
correct on the.
I gave it to him, but I'll give it to you.
Okay.
You go.
I just put
sure.
it.
Want me to go? So I'm Dennis Wharton with the NAB, Executive Vice President of Communications. Happy to be here with Actors, Reporters, and Kurt Kelly. Let me start over. I'm Dennis Wharton, the NAB Executive Vice President of Communications. I'm happy to be here with Kurt Kelly and Actors Reporters, the online service that I never miss.
Okay. No, that's good.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Take care.